This is Acholi Land in northern Uganda. Traditionally, the Acholi have had a customary land tenure system where families own large tracts of land they use to grow a variety of food crops. In fact, Acholi Land once prided itself as the food basket of the nation. However, all this changed as a result of a 20-year-old armed conflict between the Lord's Resistance Army rebels and the government of Uganda. According to 2006 statistics from the Office of the Coordination for Humanitarian Assistance, OCHA, more than 1.8 million people were internally displaced in northern Uganda. Many families disintegrated in the process of seeking protection from government in IDP camps. Here, life was hard. People lived in congestion, depended on food aid to survive, making them lose their dignity, livelihood, and family structure, which was the pillar of the Acholi community.
7 o'clock in the morning, you could see people staggering, you know, or you could see people surrounding, you know, sitting around and drinking waregi. 7 in the morning.
It is only after the signing of the comprehensive peace agreement between the government of Uganda and the LRA rebels in 2006 that people gradually started returning to their ancestral land. Coming back home was indeed a new dawn for the people of Acholi. However, it was also the beginning of new conflicts, mainly revolving around land ownership.
We stayed for almost 20 years in the camp, and now we have come back home to the real land. And here we have a lot of challenges that we are facing as pertaining our staying in the village. We still have shortages of water. Distance, you have to move some 1 kilometer, then look for sources of water. We also had land wrangles. When we were in the community, people, when we were still in the camp, people were squeezed. And when we come back here, everyone wants that, okay, this is my land.
It's because people had stayed in the camps. When they were going back, many of them didn't know where they had settled before. So they ended up settling in wrong places, which led to these conflicts. And you can also find out that some of the people who were in the camps died, leaving their children in the camps. And these children did not know where the parents had settled. And when they only rely on the relatives to guide them on where their parents were previously settled.
We used to have a lot of that problem, whereby youth, they keep on fighting over a small piece of land. Because they've stayed in the camp, they are now back home. They don't know exactly where their land starts from and where it begins from. So when they go home, they begin fighting for the land, saying that this one also belongs to me, this one also belongs to me.
To support government's effort in the peace, recovery and development plan for northern Uganda, the UN in Uganda provided a peace building fund to support peace building and reconciliation process in northern Uganda and facilitate programs aimed at empowering communities to take charge of their own lives.
In the past, everything is different.
Kwalo Acholi, the embodiment of the Acholi traditional authority. The local chiefs got an intensive training on human rights issues and how to uphold them. The trainings also focused on the rights of women who traditionally seemed to be left out. There was an urgent need to strengthen traditional courts because they provide alternative dispute resolution mechanism, especially in resolving land disputes faster.
People don't want to go to court, the formal court system anymore. It takes very long. There's the issue of affordability. You know, you may have to go to a lawyer, and you know the lawyers, and you know the court system. You come today, it is postponed, adjourned, and you get tired. But a case that could have taken 5-6 years, you know, when the court refers them to the traditional leaders or the traditional institution to resolve the case, it takes us less than a day. We sit in the morning, by lunchtime the issue is resolved.
They still have the clans, and these clans have heads. So those heads sit and they resolve some of the issues. That is one way of settling those matters.
Sometimes now we also encourage people to settle disputes amicably, like we do mediation activities. And this one, we work a lot with the traditional institutions and authorities at grassroots.
They actually say the chief palace is open, you know. You either come to say hello to the chief, you are welcome, or you come with your problem and let the chief know. In a way.
More than 70% of Uganda's population is below 30 years of age, and more than 50% of this is under 15 years. In Acholi land, the percentage is even higher. Many adults died during the insurgency, leaving a young generation with an eroded culture but a responsibility to rebuild Acholi land.
Well, we were picked by Youth Strengthening Strategy, so-called YSS, which is a community-based organization who identified us and said they wanted to work with us, build our capacity on peace building. So they came, picked a representative, and we attended. We got training, 4 days training intensive, which we were able to get information how we can document a community event that is happening in our society.
YSS feel that if they bring the youth on board, it will make sure that the number of violence reduces a bit. So YSS pick them and train them properly so that they be the peacemaker, the youth, because they are majority, so they should be in front to make peace.
It is interesting to listen to the positive impacts that the program has had on the youth. Some have even put up income-generating projects out of their own initiative.
I feel youth should engage themselves in agriculture. Like me, I started digging the garden. I wanted to plant pines so that in future have a lot of resources, investment, that when my child grow, I'll have some money that has kept aside. So we wanted them to engage in agriculture.
Like in many other armed conflicts, many unexploded devices were left littered in overgrown bushes in Acholi land. This caused serious injuries during the return process and even after the people had already settled. The Peace Building Fund financed the African Youth Initiative Network to provide reconstructive plastic, surgical, and reconstructive orthopedic surgeries to the victims of war in the Acholi sub-region.
Really, the impact of this intervention is a real intervention in the life of a victim of war. To get these people surgically operated, and we have been doing this with help from UN. They have been providing us with the funds for the project. So when they provide us with the fund for the project, we identify hospitals which really suits the patient's conditions. Because now not every condition can be treated from the same hospital. There are others which are taken to different hospitals depending on the condition.
A total of 574 victims of landmines from the districts of Agango, Amuru, Gulu, Kitgum, Lamwo, and Pader have benefited from this initiative. Although the Peace Building Fund has registered significant achievements, the people still have diverse and met development needs.
The government should look into another thing, example like the grant, if possible, that they should give to the youth so that the youth are engaged in activity to make this peace everlasting.
We need to be empowered with some small sub-granting. Okay, like there are so many NGOs who can really, if they could come to us, work with us in the community here, we could be more resourceful than the other NGOs who are in town, because we are community-based. We know what is affecting the community, and so doing that, it would really help a lot. Okay, we can sensitize if they also build the capacity of the group all, because we will pick only one, and they will be doing the role.
One of my appeal is that probably if other donors would come in to sustain this project, to help the victims of war, to be rehabilitated medically, and the government of Uganda to look at rehabilitation of northern Uganda in the aspect of the medical needs of victims of war.
Oh,